Let's go to the Oilers. And okay. So much was made of last season, taking that next step. The excitement in the city was back. Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl. What happened and where do we go from here?
Well, I mean, they came crashing back down to earth pretty quickly. And the same kind of background that Lotz spelled out, meetings, understanding where you are, their points, their goals for, not great, their goals against, even worse. And the big concern for the Edmonton Oilers is that they are blessed with one of the best players, certainly the fastest player in the game, but they're a slow team. So they need to – Pierce Riley went to Edmonton, thought, we want to compete with the Pacific. We want to be able to play with L.A. and Anaheim and San Jose and grind and bang. And he built a team that could do that.
Right.
The game has gotten away from that style quickly.
Changed right underneath.
Right underneath them. And so they're stuck with a whole bunch of players that are maybe not suited – to play this new system as well as they can, who have contracts. So now, similar kind of exercise for Edmonton as you did with Chicago. How do we clear out not so much money, but roster space so that we can put more age-appropriate, both in their actual age and also in the age that we're playing in, into position to be successful? So I went down and looked at who are the core pieces that are going to come back for the Edmonton Oilers next year. And so I start with the goaltenders, Talbot, Montoya. Good contracts. They're coming back, no problem. Defensemen, Klefbom and Larson, both have them back. Good contracts, good players. Darnell Nurse, one of the few players who's taken a step forward. Sekera and Russell, I probably would like to deal both of them, but I don't think I'll be able to. I think that would be just a very difficult thing to do without eating a lot of money right now. And amongst the forwards, it's crazy. But I got two guys. I got two guys that I'm going to build this team around going forward. Number one centerman, Connor McDavid. Number two centerman, Leon Draisaitl. Now, there will be other players that are currently on Edmonton that will be there next year. But these are the guys that I am focused on. We need to build around and go from there. Slapyshev, Kara, Kajula, Puljujärvi.
Ryan Nugent, Hopkins.
They'll be all around. No, no. Okay. He was not on that list for a reason.
Not.
So, now I need to clear out some money. Because I need to sign new players, I need to be able to make trades.
Because they're all wrong, in your opinion, the Edmonton Oilers. They've got it all wrong.
Not all wrong, but they got some mistakes that I need to correct. As the GM that's gotten in there, I need to correct. So we're going to start by the obvious. Unrestricted free agents to be. I am going to trade every potential unrestricted free agent that they have available that will get anything this year. So that means Patrick Maroon, you've done great service here, great value. We're going to move you along and we'll get, whether it's a prospect or a pick, we're getting something back for you. Mark Letestu, I think there'll be a market for a right-handed shot.
Yep.
Centerman,
not
fourth line guy.
Year, but you can move him.
But you can move him and get something. Mike Camilleri, maybe, maybe not. Maybe a flyer for a fifth, sixth, seventh rounder. But these
doesn't
are all
matter.
Guys.
He's off your roster.
They're cleared from the roster. That's easy. That's obvious. The more difficult ones then. So now I've cleared out three spots, three older guys, three slower guys. So now we go to the more difficult transactions. The one guy you mentioned, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, who's had a good year. And is a very good player, and he's under control for a couple more years at $6 million, which is not out of the question for the kind of player he is. But if I have McDavid making 12.5, I got Draisaitl making 8.5, I can't have my third line center making 6 because there's just not enough money going around. Yeah. So I would like to move Ryan Nugent-Hopkins as my most attractive trade chip to get one of the wingers I need to play in the top couple of lines. So Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, I'm going to trade him to a team like Montreal for Max Pacioretty. If I can get Pacioretty signed to an extension, maybe. I'll trade him to the Ottawa Senators for Mike Hoffman, because I think the Ottawa Senators want to trade Derek Brassard, so now you have Duchesne and Nugent Hopkins, and maybe you'll get a pick as well with Mike Hoffman coming back, a guy who can skate, a guy who can shoot. You got a couple more years, about $5 million. Seems like we need some speed and some goal scorers in our top six. I'm going to trade Ryan Nugent Hopkins to get one of those guys. So that's my first significant transaction. And I think Ryan Nugent Hopkins, the way he's played this year, and the two-way centerman he is, can bring you a goal-scoring winger.
Yeah.
I don't think that's out of the question. So,
what are you doing with Ryan Strome?
Ryan Strome, he's also not on the list. Ryan Strome hasn't been a great fit in Edmonton. I don't want him to be my third-line center. I'm not sure if he's a good enough winger. So I'm going to look to trade him. Ideally, I'd love to get value like Jordan Eberle.
If I can get a scoring winger
for Ryan Strome like they gave up for him. But you know what? If somebody around the league thinks there's potential there, I probably have to
now
take
I know you're
less,
being facetious on
no, I'd have to take a less known commodity for him.
Right.
Maybe it's a younger guy who maybe has some upside, try to find Bill Carlson.
Right.
Or William Carlson.
Wild this season.
Somewhere
along
the way.
What's your number one priority?
But my other guy I'm going to have to clear out and is a guy that was brought into Edmonton with much fanfare, Milan Lucic, who chose Edmonton to play with McDavid, to protect him. He's got a no-move clause, which you'll have to work around.
Yeah.
They are workable, but you have to work around. I think for Milan Lucic, who's still a decent player, he's a good player. But at that contract for that length, I think you probably will have to eat a little bit of salary.
Yeah.
So if I'm looking around the league and say, who can I trade Milan Lucic for and what? For maybe $4 million of his $6 million. We retain two. They absorb six, or they absorb four. Maybe Arizona, a team that is struggling, needs some identity, needs a presence in the locker room, needs a guy
who's win. Type guy.
Rick Tocchet, yeah. Physical. They also need the salary cap hit to get to the floor. Maybe we can get something. Right. And I mean, at this point, it's probably just going to be a pick or a prospect. It's not going to be a natural return for next year. But if I'm able to clear $6 million of Nugent Hopkins, $4 million of Lucic, $3 million for Strome, that's 13 plus the $15 million in cap space they have already for next year. Now I have some space to get the Hoffmans and also plug in the last step of my quick rebuild, the UFAs.
It's a long story, but it's a quick rebuild.
No, but UFAs, and you can't go wrong here. So these are the three forwards that I looked at because their age and how well they and how they play. Riley Nash, he's my new third line center. He's having a fantastic year in Boston. I can sign him for $2.5 million for 3 or 4 years. He'll take the security. He'll like that. Michael Grabner, where's our penalty kill lots? It's awful.
It has not
last.
Been good.
Historically bad at home. He can still skate, kill penalties. He can be in your third or fourth line. He's probably not going to score 30 goals, but he'll give you
he'll
something.
He'll add some speed.
And he'll give you speed. And my last one, Josh Bailey, if it doesn't work out in the island, he's shown he can play with good players. He's still young enough that you can give him a six-year deal. Not eight, seven, but, you know, 5 or 6 year deal at around $6 million. And I think that might be something that can be attractive. And so you put those guys in amongst the forwards. Now you're rounding out with the Hoffman in the top two. And you start putting the pieces together. They're a different looking team. And the last big fish I'm looking to land, I'm going big.
Wow.
So you saw my five defensemen.
Yeah.
Secker and Russell, my third pair. I need someone to play with Darnell Nurse. I'm going big and going John Carlson.
Wow.
Right shot.
You need a right-hander and you plucked one.
And I plucked the biggest one. And you think, where are they power play? They're not great. They have no threat from the point. Wouldn't it be nice to have a right shot, able to take feeds from McDavid on the half wall on the power play? He's having a fantastic season. Now we're going to have to pay through the teeth to get John Carlson in Edmonton. It's going to go the full 7 years and it's going to be $7+ million. Easy. So this is my reconstructed forward line. Hoffman, McDavid, Puljujarvi, I like that. Bailey, Draisaitl, Kajula, Slepyshev, whoever you want to fill in there. Grabner, Nash, somebody on the third line from the existing team. Cassian's re-signed, he's on the fourth line. It's a different looking team. They can play with pace, they can play with skill, and I think they'll be able to skate in the new NHL. You saw my reconstructed defense, and they'll be able to afford all of that under the $80 million projected salary cap, given the contracts I think they'll be able to get.
All right.
A lot to do.
Yep.
And it's a huge turnover. Some moves, very challenging, for sure, getting Carlson to sign.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe getting Bailey to sign, getting Lucci to leave. But if you're able to do those things, I think the team would be better off going forward than they are right now.